Hey guys, hope you're having a good day so far. I wanted to share something with you that I read with Psalms 139. It speaks about how God really knows us, his perfect knowledge of us. Did you ever think about that? Like, God really knows everything about us. Like, everything about us. Our thoughts, everything we do. Things we don't probably want him to know. But the thing is, he does know it, and he still loves us. Right? Like, that's kind of crazy. A lot of people, we don't share everything with them because we're afraid that if we do, they might not like us, or they might not love us, or they'll be upset with us, or maybe we'll be embarrassed, or not accepted, or whatever it is. But the crazy thing is that God knows that, and he still is desiring to have a relationship with us. He knows everything about us. Everything. There's nothing that he doesn't know. I know I've spoken about it before, even all the hairs on our head. And I think of just my hair alone. I'm like, that's a lot of hair, God. Do you know all the ones that fell on the floor in the bathroom too? And he does. It's crazy. So in this Psalms, it's with King David. And it said David had a heart after God's own heart. Right? And that's what we all try to, you know, that's what God wants us all to try, to have his heart. Hashem said we all have that because we know what's going on in this world, right? That we know they don't have God's heart, and that's what we all have to strive for. I don't know if you hear the song in the background. I actually thought of this today, and then someone else confirmed it when they posted that Whitney Houston song, Your Love Is My Love. Right? And it's talking about if Judgment Day to came and World War III happening. And, you know, we don't know that day could come. I mean, in 2020, we don't know what could happen next. So for me, because I love you all, I want to share God's word with you and let you know that he does love you, you know. And he has a place for you. He has a kingdom for you. He has a place in heaven for you. Para santo. He really wants to share this with you. He wants to share eternity with you. And there's something that we must do to be able to do that. God forbid, right? We left there and we didn't get to spend eternity with him. So actually, the sweatshirt I have on, Acts 2:38, it tells us to repent and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of our sins. And for the remission of our sins, and that he will fill us with the Holy Ghost. It's a promise to us. So you could read Acts 2:38. I didn't say the whole thing, but it what it says is to repent and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remissions of sins, for the promises unto you and your children and your children's children. So what I was saying is that it's symbolic for what Jesus did for us, right? He went on the cross for us. He died for us, right? For our sins, you know. He took our sins on him. He was wounded for our transgressions, right? So when he went on the cross, he had you in mind. Every stripe on his back, every wound that he took, when they spit in his face, when they stabbed him and pierced him in his side, that was for you. And the reason why the Bible tells us, and why Jesus, our Lord, told us to be baptized, is so we can have our sins washed away. Even he was baptized as a demonstration by John the Baptist to show what to do. And it says that then the Holy Spirit fell on him because he was showing us what was to come. Because after he died on the cross for us, he resurrected to heaven. And he became fully divine, fully God, right? And he became our Lord. And then he came back, right, 3 days later. 3 days later, you know, he came back and they saw him alive. He resurrected. And 50 days later, he came on the day of Pentecost and he filled the church, the first church, the apostles, with his spirit. And they were able to do the same things that Jesus was able to do. they were able to heal the sick. They were able to deliver people from things that, from evil spirits. They had evil spirits on us. And sometimes we don't even know the things that, you know, are coming against us. So God wants to do that for you. And, you know, some of you might know God and love God and say, oh, I have my own relationship. And that's exactly what he wants. But he wants to take you deeper. So the first step is the new birth. And that's Acts 2:38. And in Acts 2:38, it's telling us to repent, right? So that's saying, God, I don't want to live that life anymore. I want to turn away from it and I want to come to you, right? This doesn't mean saying sorry. It means, God, I need your help. I need you to help me turn away from my past and give me a new life. Give me the life that that you have for me. And that's what he's calling us, every one of us. You know, it says that, you know, it's his hope that no one should perish. And in this hour, I think it's so important, you know, for people to know this. And I know some people might not receive it and some will receive it, and I hope you do. But if you love God, I want you to look in the book of Acts. Read Acts 2. And when you get down to Acts 2:38, see what it's saying. So this is now, right, the apostles, you know, telling them, the people, the Gentiles, what to do to be saved, right? So this is putting your faith to works. And he's bringing them, you know, to baptism for repentance, right? So it's, you know, asking God to change our ways. And the baptism represents the washing, the cleansing, right? Because that's what he paid for us on the cross. So once we take that step forward, you know, it says that we are baptized onto him. And we want to be able to spend eternity with God. So it's really important that we just don't believe that, you know, Jesus is Lord. That we actually move forward to what the Bible is instructing us, which is his word. So that's telling us to do the new birth experience. And then to follow in his instructions from that point on. And that is to have a relationship with him. To seek his face every day. To get in his word. Because he is the word. It says that he is the word that became, the word that became flesh. And that's him. And it says the word will last past everything. I'm paraphrasing. Even when everything else is gone, God's word will still exist. So that's why it's so important for us to really get into his word, you know, every day. Because it's like our manual. It's literally like an instruction of what we should do. So God really, he knows us, you know. And in this Psalms 139, it's showing how much he really knows us. And he wants us to have the new birth experience. He wants to cleanse us of our sins. He wants to give us a new life, right? He wants to resurrect us and give us something brand new. But really, it's because he wants us to spend eternity with him. With him forever in our glorified bodies. Like literally in paradise. And I know some of you might not know this. I didn't know it. But this is the way that we are going to be able to be, you know, baptized into him, you know, into his kingdom. And it's important to do it in the name of Jesus, because that's what the Bible tells us to do. That's what they did. That's what the first church did. So I just ask you that, to look into Acts 2:38, but really to read the book of Acts. Acts means action, right? So that's what they did. They took action after Jesus, you know, was with them on the earth. Through his ministry and showing them what to do and how to love people and, you know, how to, you know, bring people to him. And Jesus was casting devils out of people and he was healing them and he was healing the sick. And he wants us to be able to do the same thing. That's what he called us to do. So, you know, if that's something that has been on your heart and you want to get closer to God, let me know. We could do a Bible study. If you want to come to church, or you want to just, you know, even do something over the phone. I know with COVID and stuff, some people, you know, don't maybe want to do that. But we could even do like a Zoom or something. But it's really important to understand what God's word is saying in these days. So in Psalms 139, sorry, I can't talk today. It says, "Oh Lord, you have searched me and know me. You know my sitting down and my rising up." Think about that. He knows everything. He knows when you wake up. He knows when you lay down. He knows every thought that you have, even the ones you don't speak out loud. I know. Exactly. That's why he tells us to repent daily, right? Because this flesh sometimes, you know, is subjected to this world. That's why we have to get baptized, because it says we were born into sin, right? So he wants to give us a new life so we can have eternal life with him later on. So then it says, you understand my thought afar off. You comprehend my path, my laying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word on my tongue, but behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. Right? He knows everything. You have hedged me behind and before. Right? He knows our coming and our going. He knew us before we were in the womb, it says in Jeremiah, right? So he knew us before we even existed. Think about that one. I'm not going to touch that today, but think about that one. And laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful to me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Like, I thought about that today, and I just started praying, and I just felt God's spirit on me, and I'm like, It really is. It's like I can't even attain it, you know? Like, he knows everything about us. He designed us. And sometimes we don't even pay attention to him. We're distracted by everything else. And he's like, I'm here. He really just wants you guys to get closer to him. He wants all of us to get closer. That's what he desires. It's not some of the things that maybe the world is trying to tell you. That's not God. He wants a relationship. He wants to be everything to you. Your father, your partner, your best friend. He wants to be everything. Your Lord. Your Lord. That means we need to reverence him. We need to fear him. Not fear him like, oh, I fear him like, you know, something like he's going to do something bad to me. Fear him as in respect, like when you have respect for your parent or an authority that we're supposed to, right? He is the ultimate authority, right? And I could tell you, when you get in his presence sometimes, you're so overwhelmed, you don't even know what to do. You're so overwhelmed by him, because that's how beautiful his presence is, that you don't even know what to do at times because you're so overwhelmed. So imagine when we see him in heaven, what that's going to be like. Right? I know. I can't even put it into words. But then David goes into here and he says, it is high. I can't even attain it. Then he says, where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? We can't go anywhere. He's everywhere. He's the Alpha, the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. There is not one place that he is. Wait till you see what comes up next. It says, if I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I made my bed in hell, behold, you are there. The Bible tells us he went to hell and took the keys. He went there. He was there. What he did on that cross, right? He was there. There is not a place that God hasn't been. Why? Because he created all of it. All of it. And the only, well, let me not touch it, but the hell wasn't created for us. That was created for the enemy. And that's why he has given us, he has given us a way to be with him forever. To be knitted to his heart, and that's what he desires. I'm sorry, I lost my place. It says, if I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you. Right? Because he created it. It can't hide from him. Right? It says, what's in the dark will come to light. Because he is the light. He is the light of the world. And he called you to be a light. And he called me to be a light. He called every one of us to be a light to this world. And we know that it's dark right now. So we have... You know, a choice to make to answer the call. I know some of you could feel it right now. He's pulling on your heartstrings. And he's been desiring to get closer to you. Stop blocking him out. Invite him in. God is a gentleman. And he's knocking. He's knocking. Are you going to open the door? He's waiting. He wants to sit down, it says he wants to sit down and dine with us, right? He wants to eat with us. That's what they did, right? He sat down. That was the first thing they did. They went to the wedding feast, right? Where he had his first miracle, where he made the wine, right? And they said it was the best wine. Usually they save the worst wine at the end, right? But it was the best wine. That was Jesus' first miracle. But it was symbolic. It was symbolic to what he did on the cross. Because the blood that he shed was for you, and it was for me. And that's what, you know, it represents. And he wants to know that he's waiting for you open arms. It doesn't matter what you did. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Even if you already know him, it doesn't matter what you did, right? He's telling you that he just wants you to repent and come to him. That he can take all that away, but you just have to surrender it to him. That's what he's asking us to do, and it's not always easy. But if we come to him and ask him, you know, sometimes we can't get the words out. I'm just saying, Jesus, help me, right? If you don't know what to say, just say him, his name, and he'll be there. But you got to let him in. The rest of it says, where am I? For you form my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. Oh, see, maybe this right here, right, ties in with Jeremiah. I can't remember which verse. It's Jeremiah something. For you formed me in my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works. I'm going to read that again, right? For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I praise you. For I am fearfully and wonderfully made. He has made you perfect in his image. Stop trying to be somebody else. We need to stop trying to be someone else. We need to stop trying to be what the world is telling us to be. We are called to be who he made us to be. And he made you wonderful. He made you wonderful. So don't let anybody else tell you that he didn't, because the God of the universe created you. I think he knows a little bit better what he's doing than anybody else in this world or any other, you know, social media or these apps or anything like that. Honestly, that's why I put a hat on today, because I'm tired and I had physical therapy for this and I'm like, God, I don't know if I want to do this right now. You know, so I'm not saying I'm totally comfortable in it, but I've come to terms, right? God has made us in his image. And to me, his opinion is more important than anybody else's. And it says that, you know, he wonderfully made us. Marvelous are your works. Marvelous, right? That word marvelous, just think about that word, marvelous. Marvelous are your works. And that my soul knows very well. Right? Think about the stars. Think about like that beautiful sunset you might see, or the moon at night, or every tree, every flower. How marvelous is that? God is the best artist. He is the creator of creators, right? There's nothing above him. There's nothing beside him. There's nothing, you know, that can top God. He has made it all. It says, my frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in you, book they all, were written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them. How precious also your thoughts of me, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they would be more in number than the sand when I awake and I am still with you. So he's saying, like, you know, you already knew. You wrote me down in your book, God. Like, the thought of me came to you. And, like, he thought of us. He thought of you. He said, I need a Billy. He said, I need a Stacy. He said, I need a Susan. I don't know, whoever's watching this. I need a Janine. I need a Natasha. I'm going to call some of my friends. I need a Jackie. I need a Tatum. I'm going to call my sister. I need a Frank. I need a Guy. I'm going to call my family. Right? I need a Marie. That's my mom. I don't know if she'll watch this, but I'm going to call her. You know, he needed us. He needed us. You have a purpose. You have a purpose. He needed a Jenna. He needed a little guy. Those are my niece and nephews. Right? He needed each and every one of you. So don't ever think you don't have a purpose. He has a purpose. Call the enemy by what his name is. He is a liar. Liar. That's it. Right? He's a liar. He is the father of lies. But the Father of Lights has called you, and he's called you for a purpose. He's called you onto him. He's called you into eternity. So he wants you to open the door. I hope that you do. It goes into a little bit more, but really what it's saying is that God knows everything about us. He has designed you perfect in his image. He has made you marvelous. He has made you wonderful. He has called you for such a time as this. Right? So don't ever let the enemy come in and tell you something different. Don't let this world tell you something different. Don't get caught up in your flesh and the pleasures of this world, because it's all going to be gone. And we see that now. And I'm just going to give a little short testimony. Like, even during this time, right, I've had so much stuff happen to me in this last 2 years, and God has been with me. God has been with me. I've had jobs taken away. I had my health taken away. I had a car accident taken away. And guess what? He's restoring me. He's healing me. And yes, I'm going to physical therapy. I have a great physical therapist. But I know it's God that's healing me. I know it's God that's healing me. I'm not even going to get into all of it, because I'm not claiming any of it. God is healing me. He's restoring me. And he's going to bring me back even better than I was before. Right? Because he's refining me. He used these things to make me better. You know, he has taken care of my needs. He has blessed me on top of it. On top of it, he has blessed me. And I'm like, wow, God, let me be a blessing to others. Because when he trusts us, he knows we'll be a blessing to others. And I'm like, wow, you got my back. You know, let me get somebody else. I mean, I always like to help people out and stuff like that too. But, you know, I've been burnt by, you know, helping people out too. And God is teaching me to just trust him. So if he tells me to do something, I do it. Because it's for him. It's for him. It doesn't matter if it grieves my flesh. It's for him, if it's pleasing to him. Sometimes I'm not, you know, so quick to do things. But I'm getting better at it because of his grace. So, you know, I just tell you this, that God has a purpose for you. He knows everything about you. He created you from the dust and made you perfect in his image. So I ask you, it's the third knock, right? He's confirming. Read Revelations 3:20. It says he's standing at the door and knocking, and that he's waiting to be invited in to sit down and eat with you. I hope you answer the door. God bless you. Now it's judgment day. And I'm standing on the front line. And the Lord asked me what I did with my life. I will say, I spent it with you. If I wake up in World War III, I see destruction and poverty. It's okay if you're coming with me.